Thank you very much.
Something was doing the right thing when I went away. Now being back should be so simple, but I keep getting these mixed signals from everyone. Why do folks sit and judge me who ain't seen what I've seen? Did what I done? Didn't I burn? Didn't I bleed enough?
I am deeply honored to introduce to you now one of the great Americans, a medical doctor, family man, America's leading champion of the Constitution, and a man, God willing, who will be the next president of the United States, Dr. Ron Paul.
Family that are with me tonight, my wife and my granddaughter, Valerie and Carol, my wife here. You know, I've been asked a couple times today by a few people in the press and wanted to know how we're going to do tomorrow. Hello. You know, I tell them I don't know exactly, but I know we're going to do a lot better than they claim we're going to do. Those stories about a few spammers out there running our campaign just aren't true. I think there's more to it than a few people. And it looks like quite a few arrived here tonight, and they've been around in this state. So a lot of things can be happening. But what makes me so excited about all this is the fact that we're philosophically oriented. We believe in something worth fighting for and voting for. That we've been on the wrong path, that we do not have the strength that we had at one time. We are not a strong American in what we stand for. But something has happened along the way that we've interpreted our strength as that of being a military powerhouse that bullies ourselves around the world. That is not strength. Strength is to believe in freedom and liberty and setting a good example to the world. Don't have to worry about is we are a strong nation. We are a strong nation militarily, and nobody will dare attack us. During the time that the Soviets were at their height, they had 40,000 nuclear weapons. I was called to duty in 1962 during the Cuban crisis, and this was a very, very difficult situation, very difficult times. But we won that. We won that without fighting and without a war. We won it by standing strong and standing up to their efforts. And yet, it did not require us to invade the Soviet Union. What we need, though, now today is strength and confidence in our own beliefs and convictions that we don't have to force ourselves around the world. We can spread our goodness much easier if we just set the example that needs to be set and do the job right here at home. In the first debate, seems like a long time ago, approximately a year ago, I noticed that at that time something different was still going on in the country. I was reluctant to get into the race. I was talked into doing this by a lot of different people who believed the time was right. And I was a bit skeptical about this and talking about, you know, I don't know how the young people respond. I don't know how many there belong to the remnant of the true believers in our country and the Constitution. And therefore, I was reluctant. But over the past year, let me tell you, I have removed that skepticism. I am now a true believer that this country is ready for some real changes. There's one thing that we have to recognize to get the changes. We have to recognize what the problems are. Because if you talk about making changes glibly and not identifying the problems, nothing much will happen. I think that's what's been going on for a long time. People pay lip service to limited government and to balanced budgets, but nothing ever seems to happen. And yet today, the American people are sick and tired of what is happening. They've been told one thing and they get something else. But what is happening today is the American people are waking up and starting to realize that we're probably in worse shape than a lot of people in the government tries to tell us. They tell us that the economy is sound, there's no unemployment, and there's no inflation. I mean, what type of a PhD do you need to realize that inflation is a real problem in this country and we ought to stop it? No way we can have a strong America without a strong dollar. This idea, this myth that is perpetuated by many economists have a great deal of influence in our government for the past 50 or 60 years. They believe a weak currency is good because they say, well, this will enhance the exports and it's going to solve all our problems. Well, today, all you have to do is look at the financial markets, whether it was the end of last year or for the last 2 years or 7 years, or today, this very day. The dollar is going down. The diminishing power and value of a currency reflects the strength of a country. Most great countries disappeared not because of military invasions, but because of economic consequences and a weak currency. The Soviets did not need to be invaded. They defeated themselves. They had a system that was not viable. And what we're doing today is not viable. We cannot remain strong as a vibrant nation if we continue to spend beyond our means, if we continue to think that we can police the world. We cannot do it. It's time we brought our troops home from around the world. On numerous occasions, especially since Bhutto has been murdered over in Pakistan, about what am I going to do? What would I do about Pakistan? Well, I would do a lot less, a lot sooner. That's what I would do. The problems in Pakistan that we do face, the mess that is there, is something that was predictable by an interventionist foreign policy of ours. Because we prop up too many dictators around the world. We have propped up countries like Saudi Arabia since World War II, and a lot of people in the Middle East resent that because they're a puppet government and they're dictators. How much did we just send over to Pakistan? When we chased Osama bin Laden from Afghanistan over into Pakistan, we relinquished the fight at Tora Bora. Osama bin Laden went into Pakistan. We said, oh, we'll get our friend old Musharraf. He'll take care of it. So what did he want? What did he want to take care of it? He wanted $10 billion. He got the $10 billion, and Osama bin Laden is free. We don't need any more of that type of policy. We need to keep that type of money here at home and spend that money here. Part is the repercussions. Well-intended policy by many Americans to go over there and think it's necessary for us to be the policemen of the world. But even Bhutto, before she went back in, accused the United States of undermining Pakistan because she said it was a bad idea propping up a military dictator. Musharraf was a dictator that overthrew an elected government. And she said, this will incite the Al-Qaeda. This will incite the radicals. She was speaking from her viewpoint. And yet, what did we do? We softened our stand and our support for Musharraf. We shifted over to supporting Bhutto, and we were ushering her back into power into that country. A lot of resentment. It's a lot of mess. But that isn't our job to figure out those messes. It's their job. It's the part. It's up to the Pakistanis to decide who they want to run their government. Sometimes they'll get a good one. Sometimes they'll get a bad leader. But the problem, the job we have as a country, and the job the president ought to have, is trying to get along with these people, talk to them, and work it out. But not to tell them what to do, and not to think that our CIA can put into power certain individuals around the world. It leads to nothing but trouble. And the sooner we change our overall foreign policy, the better it will be for us in this country.
Serve a position to not even belong to the United Nations. Wasn't a very good year. 1913 gave us the income tax, the 16th Amendment, and the IRS. And what's wrong with getting rid of the income tax and the 16th Amendment? And of course, I'm already taking a very modest position on the monetary system. I do take the position that we should just end the Fed.
It was said that this gave us an opportunity to go after Iraq. The plans had been in place for a good many years, matter of fact, more than a decade, to go in and have regime change in Iraq. And yet 9/11 had nothing to do with it. And there was no Al-Qaeda in Iraq. And there were no weapons of mass destruction, but the hype built into the media and through the politicians and drumbeats of war said that we have to go to war. And then the worst part of all that is we went to war under the wrong set of circumstances. Why don't we as a nation demand that we look to the Constitution and never go to war unless it's declared by the people through their members of Congress? Now they say that if we don't stay there, things will be chaotic. They're pretty chaotic, and we know it, and it's costing a lot of lives, ours and theirs, and yet who says it'll be chaos if we leave? You know, it's those same group of people said that when we go in there, it'll be a cakewalk, and it won't be a problem, and that will welcome us with open arms, and that everything will be paid for by the oil. You know what happened, everybody knows what happened, it didn't quite go that way. But those same individuals are telling us if we leave, there's going to be chaos, and we're supposed to believe them and keep our troops there. That is what happened in the 60s when I was in the Air Force. I was in there for 5 years, and they kept saying, you know, if we ever leave Vietnam, you know, it'll be a disaster. There'll be radical communists, communism will spread, there'll be a domino theory. It didn't happen that way. I mean, they became capitalistic. What has been achieved with Vietnam in these later years after we left could not be achieved with war. It was achieved in peace because we did what the founders advised. We started talking to the Vietnamese. We started trading with them. We started traveling back and forth. And now we invest over there and their president comes over here. And what about China? You think China became more communistic after we started talking to them? No, they got a whiff of capitalism. Now they're our banker.